Hello, and thank you for tuning in to Opera 101 with Holy City Arts and Lyric Opera, aka Halo. The presentation you're about to see, Ripping Your Guts Out with Puccini and Friends, is part of a series we at Halo have called From Soup to Nuts, Devouring Opera with William Berger. I'm going to read a biography of William's before we get into the conversation. William Berger was born in Los Angeles in 1961 in a multicultural, bilingual English and Spanish household. He is the author of several books on opera, including Wagner Without Fear, Verdi with a Vengeance, and Puccini Without Excuses, vintage books, and wrote the tribute Chris de Blasio in Loss Within Loss, Artists in the Age of AIDS, University of Minnesota Press. His most recent book is Speaking of Wagner, Talking to Audiences About the Ring of the Nibelung, Academia Press, 2020. As a freelance writer, he has written on a variety of subjects, including architecture, religion, and sports, and wrote erotic fiction for several long-extinct periodicals. His new book, Seeking Opera's Sublime Cash, is slated for publication in September 2021. William Berger is a commentator for the Metropolitan Opera and is heard on Met Opera Radio's Sirius XM broadcasts and the podcast series In Focus, and is responsible for the Met's Opera Quiz. Berger has also been a frequent contributor to NPR Music and Arts Programming and was formerly the host of WNYC's Overnight Music, which included the weekly show El Salon, focusing on Hispanic issues in classical music. He maintains a busy lecture and live presentation schedule throughout the U.S. and Canada in a wide variety of venues, from the Smithsonian Institution, Canadian Museum of Human Rights in Winnipeg, and many others, on artistic, political, and other topics. His recent articles have appeared in the publications of arts institutions from Los Angeles to Paris, and he is a keen and active supporter of new music in a variety of genres, especially his predominant passion of metal. Berger has been producing and participating in live showcases of new music and performance in New York, including the series Mergers and Compositions, built around music, fiction, poetry, dance, and other arts. He lives in New York's East Village with Stephen Miller, his partner of 25 years. As you can see, William's very qualified to help us learn how to devour opera more and more. Enjoy this lecture.
That was an exhausting biography. It's all true, but oh my God, I almost passed out during it. And yeah, it's not that Stephen Miller. It's a different Stephen Miller. Just thought I'd mention it. Hello, everybody. My printer decided to not communicate with my computer. So I have notes over here today. So if it looks weird, that's what's going on. Thank you for coming here. I only just finished my lunch myself. Just had my orange. I appreciate you spending some time with me as we're, are we coming to the end of the Zoom meeting era? I don't know. We'll see. We just don't know, but we're coming to the end of this. And, my final thing to share with you in opera, which is not the end, doesn't complete the whole story of opera, but it gives us a good overview, brings us to, Puccini and his friends and the sort of opera that we call Verismo. And I'll talk about that a little bit more in a moment, because I'll tell you the truth. The fact of the matter is, I've said this before in webinars, all I really want to do in life is sit around, eat snacks, and talk about Verismo. It's my favorite thing to talk about, not because it's my favorite form of art, but because it's my favorite form to talk about. Part of that is because I think it needs it. It needs talking about. Because it's, if you noticed, we've talked about opera overview, but then Mozart, Verdi, Wagner, and now Puccini and Verismo. And what we've been talking about without even necessarily realizing it is different structures of ways to present opera, which is, as we said right at the beginning, not a type of music, but a form of drama in which the pertinent information is primarily, but not exclusively, sung. And there are different ways to, and remember in Wagner, I had said that Eileen Farrell, the great singer from Staten Island, her neighbor said, oh, I don't like Wagner. And she said, that's because you don't know how to listen to him. And that's exactly right. In other words, that neighbor was listening to one form of music with a head that was tuned for other structures of music. So there's no way you can like it. So what we're really talking about here are different shapes, if you will, of telling stories through music, different shapes of music. And Puccini specifically worked in one particular way, a way that is not well understood by English speakers. And so that's what I want to look at a little bit, even though Puccini is very popular. But what I'm trying to get is, it's even better than its popularity, much better. That it's not just pretty. Remember, I said this before, you don't come here, you don't come to the opera for the pretty music, because there are much easier, much cheaper ways to get pretty music. You come here for truth, and that's what we're after. And Verismo, which a lot of critics translate as realism, you have realism in film and whatever, it's not. Vero means true, it's truthism, and that's really important. And if you have relatives from Italy, as I do, many, you know that there's a difference between fact and truth. They're two different things. When I used to call my Aunt Rose, she should rest in peace, and she said to me on the phone, do you know what the landlord said to me today? I was not expected to believe that the landlord said those actual words. I was expected to listen for the truth of her story. In other words, what's she getting at here? It's a way of telling stories. Okay, I want to look at Puccini first by looking at some other things. And first I want to look at the year 1893, which is the year Puccini's first very successful opera, Manon Lescaut, still in the repertory, hit and made a big sensation. So what's going on in 1893? A lot. You've got electricity happening, you've got a whole sense of modernism emerging, but you also have a sense of, well, in the music world, in the opera world, you have this idea of, what do we do after Verdi and Wagner? Where are we going? Wagner had died in 1883. Verdi was aging. He still had some great stuff left in him, but he was 80 and was, of course, you remember in Verdi, he'd been saying since he was 25, I'm never writing another opera again. At some point, they realized we're going to need to figure out what we're doing after Verdi. And and certainly after Wagner, who genuinely was dead. Another thing that was emerging in the late 19th century was something that we take for granted, but didn't really exist the way we think of it beforehand, which is nationalism. In other words, people in different countries were thinking, you know, we should be writing music and telling stories that come from our own traditions. This sounds tautological now, but at the time it was, what? You know, what are you, like Russians? We should do operas based on Russian music and Russian stories. In 1790, this was incomprehensible. This was incomprehensible. Russian people who could afford it said, obviously, we speak French and our music is taught by Italians and we tell stories about ancient Greece and Rome, and that's what you do. And now people are saying, maybe there's a Russian way of doing this. And not just Russians, Czechs, Brazilians, Americans with Gottschalk and Victor Herbert and others, Mexicans, people in many countries. In fact, for the Czechs and the Finns and the Norwegians and the Danes and a lot of people in Central, Northern, and Eastern Europe, it was a way of saying, we are a country. Look, we have this tradition And we can write opera just as well as Germans and Italians. So you had Dvorak was emerging. He happened to be living in New York, but whatever. He was Czech. And the French were making a move and saying, like, you know, thanks for the Italians and Germans for coming up with all this stuff, but we'll take it from here. And really in the 1890s, a lot of the newest ideas and biggest ideas were coming out of France. We had Jules Massenet, who's still in the repertory, writing operas that were so French, they just screamed, I'm French. Manon, different from Manon Lescaut, but Manon, which is basically about a woman of Paris, of course, being a woman of Paris. It's a French myth. So this is coming in. Now, speaking of the French, and then we'll start listening to music, but I really want to set this up. The French came up with, also in the 19th century, and also part of the emergence of the Industrial Revolution, Europe and the Americas and other places, a different way of writing books, novels. And you had the third person omniscient narrator. Like, we think again that they always had that, didn't they? Not quite. So the idea of telling a story by saying, John was walking down the street and thinking about lunch. Before this time, you would have picked up the book and said, well, who are you to say so? And how do you know what John was thinking about or whatever? And Leo Tolstoy in Russia, of course, is doing that in a lot of people's heads. But there were French writers who really made a systemic analysis of this as the modern way to tell stories. People like Emile Zola, Gustave Flaubert, Madame Bovary, and others were really, they came up with an ism, because the French are good at saying, we have an ism now. And it was naturalism, naturalisme. And it had points, they had a manifesto. This is what we're doing with naturalism. And it included things like the third person omniscient narrator, the invisible hand of the author. Now that's important. Of course, you don't have the invisible hand of the author, but this was the ideal. That the author is not there to show you what a good poet he is, what a great writer he or she is. A lot of important women in this movement too, but is there to just tell you the facts. Later, as part of this process, 50 years later, as part of naturalism, you got Christopher Isherwood with the Berlin Stories that became I Am a Camera, right? Which became Cabaret. So the idea is the person telling you the story isn't trying to show you how educated they are. They're just telling you the facts. Also with that come a few other things. You're talking about, in naturalism, you're talking about people in a specific time and place, not in an abstraction, not, you know, like the mythology. You have so-and-so in Arcadia or whatever, and it doesn't really matter where. No, in naturalism, if it's in Paris or New York or in a certain village, this is important. And modern day, and kind of some, there was a definite scruffiness to naturalism, people as they are, not as they're supposed to be. And there is a political issue here. Now we're talking about the lower classes as they are, with life on life's terms. Someone in Sicily, a great writer, Giovanni Verga, says, this is great what the French are doing. I'm going to do it in Italian literature. And this was a big thing, because in Italian literature, there wasn't a great prose tradition anyway. It was more poetry and music. But where there was prose, there had been in the past Boccaccio in the 14th century, the Decameron, you can have really, really long sentences, just the way the Italian language works. There's a 2-page long sentence in the Decameron. It's like, these things having been done, the following people then did the other thing, which was a thing, and that's these things having been said, and so on and so forth. It goes on and on and on and on. So Giovanni Berger decided to write a story in the naturalistic style that he called Verismo, and it's 4 pages long, and it changed everything, and it's called Cavalleria Rusticana. And if you ever take Italian, and you should, I used to be an Italian teacher, I don't care where you are in the world, the first thing you'll read after you get to the grammar in Italian 101, Intro to Literature, will be this story by Giovanni Verga called Cavalleria Rusticana. And it's about a murder of passion on Easter Sunday in a very poor Sicilian village. That's it. You know, we talked about Hemingway with his prose. Verga did this years before. And there's a line I always quote it because it's my favorite. When he's talking about Alfio, who's the other man, the hero's girlfriend's lover. He was a teamster. He had a team of mules. And there's all he says about Alfio Berger is, era ricco, aveva quattro muli. He was rich, had 4 mules. And that's all you need to know about this entire world. And it jumps out at you, especially if you're used to Italian prose. These things, the which having been said, blah, blah, blah. No, boom. And it literally like slapped everyone across the face. So there are some young students at the Milan Conservatory and they're writing music. And there's a group of roommates, Giacomo Puccini, Pietro Mascagni, Ruggero Leoncavallo, all in the same dorm. And amazing, right? And they're the young hip things. And they love Verdi, but it's time for, you know, to move daddy aside and take over. We're the kids, we're the youth. And somebody came up with a one-act opera competition. A non-establishment publisher in Italy. So instead of getting bigger and bigger as Verdi and Wagner did, said, let's do a one-act opera. And Pietro Mascagni, Puccini's roommate, Puccini wrote one, postmarked it late, got disqualified. Classic Puccini. He meant to go to the post office, just didn't make it that day. He couldn't cope. Mascagni went and dropped his off and got a postmark. Mascagni said Cavalleria Rusticana. And it won, and it premiered in Rome, importantly, in 1890. And there are a few premieres you wish you were at in history. This is one of them. Remember the old print ad with the guy sitting in front of the, what was Maxell speakers or something, with his hair blowing straight back in front of the speaker? That's what must have happened. Because this opera is, how do you take a text like, it's not in the opera, but a sense of text like, era ricco, aveva quattro muli, and set it to music. Well, not the way Verdi or Wagner would have. So for instance, another thing that Mascagni thought was important was at big moments, big emotional moments where before an Italian opera, you would have a great aria. Sometimes you just have a word spoken. That comes from the French. The French love to speak. They love their language so much. Manon's always talking, but it's also naturalism. And in fact, the climax of Cavalleria Rusticana, and I'm not giving anything away here, you're supposed to know this. Turiddu, the hero, goes off to fight a duel with rustic chivalry. That's what this is, with Alfio, and he gets killed. And a woman, Ashley knows this, a woman comes running on the stage, and the end of the climax of the opera is not sung. She screams, "Hanno ammazzato Cumbar Turiddu." They killed Turiddu in Sicilian dialect. Sicilian dialect on the operatic stage. A woman screaming, I paid money for this. It was absolutely radical. And in fact, there is a woman who's perfected it, that if you're doing a good production of Cavalleria, you hire this one woman, she's a career, and the role doesn't have a name, and it's called Hanno ammazzato Cumbar Turiddu. They killed Turiddu, and she's the one, that's what she does, and she's got a great career. It's a different way of telling a story. famously, there's some music in it. And I'm going to skip ahead here because I keep talking about Verismo. Let's hear some let's hear the intermezzo. Actually, everybody listen to this. It'll take a moment, but you know it. Let's have a listen. I'll air conduct. Okay, you not only get a ton of information from that, but you get a ton of information in a manner that gives you another ton of information. You're not going to study that in a music school to this day. You're not going to get composition students talking about The intermezzo. That's the intermezzo. It comes in the middle of the drama, right when things are at a climax or about to be at a climax. The stage, the curtain stays up, but the stage is empty. This alone was radical. And then other things go on. Come back and we have a murder. But the music itself, once the theme starts going, there's this moment where he shows you that you're there. There's the intro and then it's like this plunk in the orchestra. There's nothing in the music that's going to show you how much Mascagni learned in music school. It's one that I am a camera, the invisible hand of the author. What he's saying is, no, it's not about that. It's about truth. It's about guts. It's about real feelings. The whole orchestra, there's no counterpoint. There's no harmony. Well, there's a harp a little, but basically no harmony. The whole orchestra is playing the same notes. So of course the old people, the traditionalists are like, so why am I paying you money for this when I could play this at home on the piano or harmonica or anything? Because it's true. Vero, verismo. This is gut level. Not only that, it's a little vulgar in that way. It just puts it right out there. And then he gets to the big plateau. It's not a climax, it's a plateau. Da 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 da. One note. Da 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 da. Wait, you didn't hear it? Let me repeat that. Da 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 da. Wait, really? One more time. Bum 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 bum. It was rock and roll. It was absolutely amazing, and it blew everybody's mind. And then, of course, you know, she comes out and screams "Anamazzato cum parturito." So, what is opera going to? What's going to happen with opera? Now, that's 1890. Puccini comes along. He sets Manolisco, which is the story of Manon that Massenet had done, but very different with sort of musical theories of Wagner. Remember him? An endless melody. Okay, so Manon Lescaut happened. And in London, the opera critic, George Bernard Shaw, that's what he did at that time, said, I think Puccini is the heir to Verdi. And everyone was like, are you kidding? Mascagni's it? No, no. He said, I think Puccini is. So Manolisco is a big hit, but it's not that different. It's a little bit of Mascagni, who we knew. It's a little bit of Wagner. It's a little bit of this. We also had some other things that we don't have time, but there were other things leading to this. You may know the opera Carmen. You do know the opera Carmen, whether you know it or not. It's part of it's in the air. And that was from 1875. And Carmen pushed toward a lot of these ideas of kind of gritty people with real emotions and this sort of thing. In tragedy, we always had common people in comedy, but to say that common people have the same right to big emotions as important people, this is radical and political. Okay, so Puccini says, what am I going to do now? And one very weird thing about Puccini was an interesting guy. Like I say, he wasn't much for school. He wasn't much for study. He didn't write theory books. One thing he always wanted to set as an opera, something somebody else was working on. And there are plenty of armchair psychiatrists who have Freudian reasons for this or whatever, but I don't know. There's something going on there. So he set Manon Lescaut while Massenet was still alive. And then his other roommate, Ruggero Leoncavallo, he with the fun name to say, he heard Mascagni's Cavalleria Rusticana and said, this is the way I'm going, this Verismo stuff. And he wrote an opera called Pagliacci about murderous clowns and the space between art and real life. And it's repertory and it's always performed with Cavalleria. It hasn't always been, but it always is now. not written by the same person, big thing. And Ruggero Leoncavallo decided to work on another story from France, from Paris, significantly, about common people living shabby lives called La Boheme. So Puccini decided, I'm going to write an opera called La Boheme. And he told Leoncavallo this. They ran into each other in a cafe, and I don't think they ever spoke again. And Leoncavallo did write La Boheme, and it's very good, and it really should be done. Gustav Mahler much preferred it to Puccini's. But, and I told Peter Gelb, you know, we should do this. And he said, can you imagine people buying the wrong ticket or whatever, or just say, getting mixed up? And I said, that could be part of the fun. We could, but anyway, no, it's not happening. Anyway, Puccini decided to work on, so Puccini was in Verdi's publisher, Ricordi, House of Ricordi. This is the Italian establishment. They signed him for lots and lots of money. And so they decided, you're our new cash cow. Mascagni's writing for other people. Mascagni never had as big of a hit as Cavallo di Rusticana, although he wrote some good other operas we should hear. But anyway, what are you going to do next? He said, I'm going to write La Boheme. And they said, are you sure? And he said, yeah. So, and Leoncavallo was with another publisher. So he got, and this is interesting, Puccini, with the money he made from Manon Lescaut, built a clubhouse, a man cave, called Café La Boheme in his backyard. He put a piano there and he had his friends. Puccini was a chain smoker, it killed him, and he played poker all the time. And he had his friends over and he talked to them and they played poker. And then he'd say, excuse me, with a cigarette in his mouth, he'd sit at the piano and write something down and go on. And he wrote La Boheme that way. And there is no work of art that is closer to how people talk and interact than La Boheme. And that's part of the reason why. La Boheme is now the world's most popular opera. It is the opera that, quite frankly, that keeps opera going. It has kept opera companies alive. Since 1920, the general manager of the Royal Opera Covent Garden in London said, the only reason we're still open is because of Boheme. And it's true. That can fool you because at first people didn't quite know what to make of it. It was not as big of a hit as Manon Lescaut had been. And part of it, it's hard to imagine now how completely different it was, because it's now become the opera that stands for all operas. But it is really interesting. It's the most, far and away, the most popular opera in the world. But I'm here to tell you, it's still actually a lot better than people think it is. And because it's so popular, not everyone rates it as highly as Wagner or Verdi, but in a different way, it's as profound. And so here's a couple of things I want to look at La Boheme, at like why it works and why it's better than we think it is. And the first, one of the things that everyone kind of said, yeah, all right, that's okay, but it wasn't a failure, but there are four acts in La Boheme, Streets of Paris. Act two takes place on the streets of Paris. There's a great crowd scene. And let's have a look at part of that, just toward the beginning of Act Two. Do we have that? I didn't send that to you, did I? Yes, I did, okay.
Thank you.
Okay, so that was from a Lithuanian opera, and I did that on purpose, like just, you know, because every opera company has a production of Boheme. That scene, of course, is there's very the most famous production at the Metropolitan by Franco Zeffirelli, which is, you know, hundreds and hundreds of people on stage and all that. But I wanted to get to what Puccini was doing here, you know, before we get to the different ways that it's done. Although it's the same idea as what we saw there, it's just bigger at the Met, humongous. But the point of Act Two, on the streets of Paris on Christmas Eve, it's very cold, but everybody's running around on the streets of Paris, is the confusion and the structure that there's this swirl of humanity. And then almost as, remember I said that Wagner invented the movie theater before anybody invented movies? We have cinematic and proto-cinematic techniques. Cinema had just been invented. This is 1896, it's premiered. And you know, the idea that there's a big picture, and then when you need to, the chorus shuts up and you hear somebody saying one thing and another. This had been done in opera before, that solo to chorus thing. We heard it in Aida, but not as subtly and as close to the conversation patterns of real life. And also what's interesting for our purposes here is that you're not supposed to really, you can't get everything on one listen. You're not meant to hear this once. That's why I, you know, when I tell people, yes, Mimi dies. It's okay if you know that. This is not a blockbuster film where there's a big reveal at the end. You're supposed to know it on the way in. You're supposed to see it many, many times. This is the whole thing. Italian operas of the 19th century, I've talked about this, but they were written so that you see them many times. That was how they were structured. Remember I told you in Nabucco of Verdi that it ran for 56 consecutive performances at La Scala in Milan? 9 times the population of the city of Milan bought tickets for it, which means people went a number of times. One theory is, and I find this very perfectly easy to believe, having been in Northern Italy in the winter, was that it was during the economic crises of the 19th century and emigrations, it was cheaper to buy a ticket to the theater, which meant the opera, than it was to heat your home. So people went back to hear the same opera over and over again until they were so sick of it that they'd rather stay home and freeze to death than hear it one more time. So the operas were written, and what I mean by written to be heard more than one time and many times is because there are too many details to catch, and there are foreshadowings that you don't know are foreshadowings. Now, right there, that big theme you heard, bum, 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 ba-da-dum, ba-da-dum. Okay, so that's in Act Two, right? Act One, Schaunard, one of the Bohemian friends, is there, and he comes in and he's got money all of a sudden, and he says, it's a whole story, and he says, tonight we're going out onto the streets of Paris where there are beautiful young women and not incidentally, so many good things to eat. There's no opera in the world, incidentally, as part of the realism of it, that has so much food, so many smells, and not all of them good, as La Boheme they're talking about. So it's pungent, but there's a lot of food, even though they're starving. And while he's saying that, he's just saying that the way I'm talking here, but the orchestra underneath is doing this thing where it's going, okay, that's in Act One. He says, let's go out on the street and all this great stuff is happening. It's Christmas Eve, by the way, did I mention that? Yeah. And then they go out there, and it's the streets of Paris, dun, 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 in brass, dun, 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 one quarter step higher in a new key, bop, 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 right? Great stuff. Then in Act Three, everything's changed, everything's gotten rotten. Winter is old at this point. It's February, they're over. You know how Christmas, there's a meme about how At Christmas, everything's a winter wonderland, and by February, it's a big gray mess of uck. Well, we have that in Boheme. She's dying, it's freezing, they're over it, and the curtain goes up and it's snowing in the morning. And what do you hear? Bum, 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 bum. It's the same theme, half as slow in a minor key. It's a memory. So you have the same theme that's, let's go out there where great things are happening, one. Then you have two, great things happen. Three, remember that night when everything was great and we were falling in love before life caught up with us and we were miserable and we're going to break up. Act three. You can't know that the first time you see it. You probably can't know that the 10th time you see it. I knew a conductor from Florida Grand Opera who said Boheme didn't really get great for him until about the 100th time he conducted it. And okay, that's an obnoxious thing to say, but there's some wisdom in it. It's actually written that way, among other things. And another thing that's happening in Act Two is there are all these things. Eat some dates. I want a coral necklace. Listen to this trumpet. It's out of tune. That's all written. It's meant to sound improvised. It's not. It's, boy, with Puccini, Ashley, tell me if I'm right, you hit your cues. You hit them as he says to hit them, loud or soft, when he says exactly. Not so with Mozart. With Mozart, you like, oh, I think I'll do this now. Okay, fine. No. It takes a lot of directing to sound improvisational, as any comedian can tell you. Now, out of those things, I'm selling fresh dates. Wait, I want a coral necklace. No, I'll buy you a hat. You don't know which are important. These are little things in life. And by Act Four, of course, the bonnet that she gets becomes the thing that breaks his heart. You can't know that ahead of time when he's buying the bonnet for her. And the idea of the little things in life is actually what La Boheme is about. And it's actually what Verismo is about. And the political radicalism of Verismo is that the little things are as big as anything, which by implication means the little people are as big as anyone, which by implication means, as LaTanya Moore said, this is the right way to say all lives matter. Now I'm going to show you why we go to the opera. And it's Act Three of La Boheme. It's late winter, everything is miserable, they're breaking up. There is another couple, Marcello and Musetta. It's very interesting. Marcello is a baritone, but Musetta is a soprano. Many sopranos sing Musetta and Mimi, both, or one or the other at various stages in their career. But they can be the same woman. In fact, are they? Are people different aspects of each other? Marcello is a painter, Rodolfo's a poet. Well, again, that's just different ways of telling a story, isn't it? Interestingly, in the Leoncavallo La Boheme, Marcello's the tenor and Rodolfo is the baritone, and the same baritone sang both baritone roles in both premieres, one in Venice, one in Turin. Yeah, and I think that means something. Okay. Why do we go to the opera? Why pay the big bucks? I'll show you. Let's watch the quartet or part of it.
Oh! Libera!
That's it. That's why we do all of this. Because you can't do that outside of an opera house. And what Puccini did there is show people in relation to each other, which shows who they are themselves. Just like we do in life. Just like you don't know who you are except in relation to other people. And then you know who you are deeper. And that they are each other. You have two couples breaking up. And one is doing it very nobly and correctly and sensitively. And the other are calling each other names and screaming at each other. And it's interesting, I once saw another great production in Chicago. I saw, it was Lucas Meacham, and who was the Musetta? Oh, I wish I could remember. Anyway, they were terrific. Joseph Kalay and Anna Netrebko in Boheme. It was absolutely terrific. And at the end of that scene, Lucas Meacham as Marcello, and who said, I wish I could remember, she was terrific. And they're screaming.
Wasn't Liz Futral?
Was it? It must have been because it was that good. And it was, so they're screaming at each other, you house painter, you witch. And normally, you know, sometimes they smash a bottle over each other's head or whatever, but they call each other those names. And then Lucas Meacham took her and just stuck his tongue down her throat. It, like, they totally made out. And I was like, that's brilliant. It was like, that's their relationship. They were like, they love to call each other names in public, got to have an audience, but whatever. They're kind of comic, and Rodolfo and Mimi are tragic. Or are they tragic too? Or aren't they all? And remember, okay, so the invisible hand of the author. Remember Zola said that? And remember Mascagni and Cavalleria, like, da, 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 da. Like, that's the invisible hand of the author. The whole orchestra is playing in unison. It's not to show off how smart of an orchestrator I am, but to tell you what I'm really feeling right now. And then we have this here, we have conversation going. And then at a certain point, they all come together. In other words, the comedy is the tragedy, is young love, is pay the rent, is how are we going to pay the rent? There's a place where it all comes together, and so do we. That Mimi is Musetta and Rodolfo is Marcello, and I am all of them, and so are you, and I am he as you are he, and you are she, and we are all together. It takes Shakespeare thousands and thousands of words to describe the divided self in Hamlet. And Puccini can do it in a minute there, and then the orchestra comes together. And the other thing that a good composer does when he or she is telling you, I mean it, is you add the trombones. Remember that in Wagner? Remember when I said, like, the orchestra kept building and building and there's no way to resolve it except the trombones come in and Die Walküre in the farewell. And slice right through the grief. And in this one, da 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 da, bum bum bum, which is also a devil's triad. And it's like, it's death. It's, I mean it. And life is really sad. That to me, act three, I've got to come on the radio after act three and say, blah, 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 blah. I've done more live broadcasts of Love O.M. than anyone in history, including Milton Cross. And every time I'm like, I need a drink of water after act three, not act four when she dies, which is another kind of tragedy, but that's it because I'm part of it and so are you. And it's like, and the feeling, it's the same thing. There's a quartet in Don Carlo, Dimitri. Well, actually, no, you don't know this because you, it's everyone except you who gets to sing in it, where all these four people who are against each other have this moment where they sing together in the sympathy of just kind of understanding, wow, life is really, really hard.
It's always a shame when the title character doesn't get to be part of that music.
Hey, you're the one who like takes the contract for Don Carlo, man. Best scene Verdi ever wrote, the tenor ain't in it. Anyway, Absolutely. Anyway, but it's that moment of where, you know what it is? It's that moment where people recognize themselves in other people. And that's what we do here. And that's, I was consulting at a conference for San Francisco Opera where we were talking about new audiences and building audiences. And we're talking about this idea of people have to see their stories in these stories that we present, but they don't have to, this is what I was telling them, they don't have to see them literally. We have to make sure they see them as Puccini and the others made it possible for us to see, like, wow, I can feel every one of those people right now saying, wow, life is really hard and letting go of love is really hard. No wonder everyone's a mess. Bump, bump, bump. Okay, let's bring this home. The other thing Puccini did, I had said that that the means, the technological means of getting the point across have a lot to do with why various operas, you have to see it with your inner eye, Kristen. How's that? Hi, Kristen, I love that you're here. The technological means, technology doesn't always mean your computer. It means all the material circumstances of making music. That's why sopranos sing in that head tone, because you have big spaces to fill up before amplification, and so on and so forth. So the material facts affect a lot of why music is the way it is, why opera is the way it is, why one opera written in 1760 in Mannheim will be different from another opera written in 1984 in Brooklyn, maybe, and so on and so forth. Well, one thing Puccini had was, I'd mentioned, the dawn of modern technology, and that includes the dawn of the recording industry. And the recording industry and Verismo Opera had a lot to say to each other. The first million-dollar seller in the recording industry was Enrico Caruso singing, not Puccini, but from Pagliacci of Ruggero Leoncavallo, Vesti la Giubba, the big clown aria. Vesti la Giubba, et cetera. Ridi Pagliacci. I'll let Dimitri do that, but you know the one I'm talking about. Not now, Dimitri, not now. I know you're tempted. But there was, it's overstating the case to say that Puccini and the others jumped on the commercial bandwagon and wrote 1 minute long arias because it fit the recording industry, but it was a great synchronicity that the sort of short, impactful arias, those tuneful arias, the things you could leave the theater humming, worked in Verismo as well as in the emerging recording industry. And what it entailed was a matter of taking melody and compacting it in a way that everybody could not only follow, but couldn't resist. And Puccini did this very well. And because melody in the 20th century became very suspect, that instead of meaning, I mean it, it meant to a lot of people, I'm faking it. Like for a TV commercial, you have a melody. So a lot of the music schools dispense with melody entirely. And you have 20th century great studies in different ways of making music. What I say with great love and respect, what I call pots and pans. This cast a certain negativity on Puccini's melodiousness. But if we think of it, especially if we listen to what the orchestra is doing, as I mean it, it comes up with something else. We have time for one more short aria. Fanciullo.
Soltanto che tutti amate a voi chiedo una grazia e una promessa che la non sappia mai come son morto.
Un minuto, sì. Breve.
All the baritone resentments on the tenor aria ever in history. No, okay, that was our friend Brandon Dromanovich. And what I hadn't seen it before, and I found this to send to Ashley, and I wrote Brandon. I was like, why have I not seen this before? I just love it. Okay, that is from La Fanciulla del West, The Girl of the Golden West, Western opera, set in Calaveras County, California. I'm a Californian, which I consider to be his masterpiece, Puccini's greatest opera, and I would die on that hill arguing it, so let's not even start. But the point of it is, this is toward the end, and it's his big moment, and it's short, and it's unlike the rest of the opera. It's, you know, four square. Remember, we talked about that with church hymns, like, you know where it's going, you know the next line, it kind of wraps it all up together. And then, you know, the third line, this is another tradition of that. The third line, he doesn't even sing. Remember in Cavalleria Rusticana, where the big moments aren't even sung? He doesn't even sing. The orchestra comes in unison, like in Cavalleria, and plays the big theme. Andrew Lloyd Webber did this to death and not as well. But this is the same thing. You have four lines and the first two, and then the third is the orchestra, and then the fourth brings it all home. Every Andrew Lloyd Webber hit is going for this. And there's also in, that was Fanciullo del West, 1910, written for the Metropolitan Opera. Happened to be the night my grandfather was born in another country, but I love that, yeah. And in 1918, he also wrote Johnny Skeeky. We're not gonna watch it, but it has the same thing. It's a comedy and people are talking here and there. It's brilliant. And then at a certain point, the young woman, the ingenue, sings the most famous song, aria, but song And it's the same idea for O mio bambino caro, da 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 da. A, B, and then the orchestra comes in. Da, 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 da. And again, the smartest music critics of the day were saying, he's so cheap, Puccini, with this melody. And it's like, no. And also, I think that's what makes people uncomfortable about opera a lot, is that they're, especially Puccini, can say, see, this is what I mean, and I really mean it. And I think that's very disturbing to people, especially in our country. You know, we like, real emotions aren't always highly regarded. You know, Italians are so emotional, you know, and these sorts of little cliches. But I think there's a lot of, well, like I said, that's why we go in La Boheme. We go for the insights, we go for the truth. Now, I'm going to close by bringing this to you in Charleston, but also to all of us really quickly. But the lessons of Verismo is a style that, other than in Cavalleria Rusticana when it started, it was never purely accomplished after that. So you get every one of these operas, and I've had the pleasure of arguing with some of the greatest proponents of Verismo, but Boheme's not really Verismo, and Tosca's not really Verismo, and Madame Butterfly, blah, blah. What is and isn't Verismo? And it really reminds me of the way metalheads argue about heavy metal. It's like, well, this isn't pure. Yeah, it's an idea. You're not supposed to get it perfect. It's an, and this idea of Verismo, the search for truth with unadorned emotional truth, moved from the opera house into movie making, into cinema. And the great explosion of Italian film during and after World War II was called neo-verismo, which we call neorealism, but remember, it's not realism, which I think as a group are, again, the best movies ever made. Bicycle Thieves, come on, that's as good as it gets. And those were the same, they were, all right, now what did Verga and Puccini and Mascagni do? And how do we do that with a camera? I am a camera, remember? And things like in Bicycle Thieves, there's a storm scene. It's like in any opera, when there's a storm, you go, something's going on here. And it's an amazing scene. And it's people running around a piazza in Rome because it's raining. And it looks completely like unadorned, like it took 3 days to film and two squadrons of the Rome Fire Department to get it right. And this movie, Open City, Roma Città Aperta, which blew this whole thing out of the water, actually had some clandestine documentary footage of a roundup of partisans who were then shot. That is part of the movie. Yeah, it's pretty disturbing. Anna Magnani's first movie. Anna Magnani, who was not a professional actor, had never been in a film before. She was a barroom singer. And the guy and the kid in Bicycle Thieves had never acted. The woman in Umberto D of Vittorio De Sica, another neo-verismo masterpiece, not only, she's 15, she not only had never been in a movie before, she had never seen a movie before. She was from the country and she came with her girlfriend to Rome to see the sights. Her parents gave them money and they said, oh, look, there's a call here for a movie. We should go. And they did, and she was cast. So the idea, the same thing, like remember the woman who screams, the idea of like, no, I'm not an elegant professional singer, but you are. But you know, the idea is I'm not presenting that side of me was taken over in film. And for a while, it was done really well. So that's the idea of Verismo that comes through. And I think that it has affected everything that has come since Puccini and Mascagni, and in interesting ways. And here's the point, and yes, there is one. Something like Porgy and Bess, which is one of my all-time favorite operas, I did not understand completely until I thought of it from the Verismo point of view. And the idea of real people having real feelings that are sometimes messy, both musically and dramatically, and because they are. And remember, like in Cavalletti Rusticana, they're talking sometimes in Sicilian dialect. It's a scandal. And, you know, in Porgy and Bess, they used to say it was bad English, but then people started saying, that's not bad English, that's good Gullah, which DuBose Hayward was a student of the Gullah language, which is now understood as a language, and wanted it this way. But also the use of the orchestra and kind of life as it is, not how it should be. So let's end with this. I'll come right back at the end. This is the love duet, the very Puccinian love duet. And that is so metropolitan because, of course, Eric Owen's an Angel Blue. Everyone will say, well, that's a Puccinian love duet. And it is, but not for the reasons people think it is. But also, you know, he sings a verse, she sings a verse, and then they sing together. I wish we had listened to them all, but that's an old technique of Italian opera. But even still, even though he's singing with her there and she's got the whole orchestra is doubling her. They're just gushing it out because this is Gershwin's way of saying, now I mean it. No one's going to say, no one who doesn't want to look really stupid is going to say that George Gershwin wrote melody like that because he didn't know how to write counterpoint. Have you ever seen a Gershwin orchestral score? It's a math test. It's an SAT math test. It's, you know, my partner Stephen used to manage cabarets and he had a rule, but people would come up and he would say, no, don't sing Gershwin. You can't. No, I don't care who you are. The pianist can play it barely, but it's too complicated. But so then when he throws the melody out at you, he's doing it for a reason. And it's that I am a camera and the people as they are, I'm just a reporter here, telling you about little people, the most unimportant people in your community who are just as important as the most important people you know. And I think it's wonderful. I think it makes for great opera. I think it makes for a great way of looking at life. Let's end there. Wait.
Bravo, Will.
Hey, you guys
coming. Hold on, we're coming.
To the intermezzo?
Say, what was that?
You guys played the intermezzo at your wedding?
Leia walked down the aisle to the intermezzo. I was waiting at the
end.
Were
you carrying a knife in your teeth? I love it.
Well, it's an amazing piece of music, like you said. And it just the emotion that is, it's super packed. And we wanted, you know, I don't know if you know this, but we're kind of emotional people. And so we
extra, as they say, for those of us who like Puccini, you're kind of.
So we wanted to start the wedding on an emotional level, on that kind of, you know, have that roller coaster started right away, and we couldn't find any piece of music that did it more than the intermezzo did. So yeah.
Not the Lacrimosa from the Requiem or something.
You know, strangely, we didn't choose that. We didn't.
You know the story about that coming from Don Carlo, right? Of course.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, that's...
I mean, not of course, because I'm so smart.
What's that story?
So there is, yes, the Verdi Requiem, which I believe is Verdi's greatest opera ever written.
Absolutely.
There's a the Lacrimosa, the music that he set to the Lacrimosa movement, he actually used previously in the duet between Don Carlo and his father after Posa's death. And it didn't quite work in the opera, but he extracted that music and put it in his Requiem. And I'm so
grateful. But nobody knew that.
No.
1970, it was discovered. And the thing is, everybody always says, oh, the Requiem, it's so theatrical. And then one of the guys who started saying that, like that's a bad thing, said that, Ashley, I'm not even dealing
with... No, we're not even going near that, Ashley.
One of the critics, an English-speaking critic from London, said, actually, the only genuinely religious music in the Requiem is the Lacrimosa, because he didn't know that it was from Don Carlo.
Amazing.
So it shows you that sometimes what's religious and what's theatrical depends a lot on who you are, not on what the music is.
Exactly.
I was in the chorus of the Requiem here at St. Ignatius Loyola with Kent Tridle conducting.
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow. And so we rehearsed the Lacrimosa at one point. And at one point, everybody, there were, I think, about 100 of us, all lost our voice at exactly the same moment. It was just like, we were supposed to come back in. When you restate the theme, and we all opened our mouths and nothing came out. 100 people. We were all choked up at exactly the same time. And he just said, we'll take a 5-minute break. It's like, right, you're having one of those moments.
So we get that a lot, especially
leave us, Dud. No, you do not walk down the aisle to Tristan und Isolde. First of all, you'll never come to the end.
Well, isn't that kind of the point? That's how marriage works, thinking. You know?
Too much thinking. We're Verismo fans. We don't think, we feel.
That's right.
It's not true.
Hey, listen, you guys, this was fun.
We just wanted to come and say thank you, Will, for bestowing upon our Opera 101 faithful everything that you've done over the past 6 lectures, plus 7 lectures, actually, maybe even 8.
You make me feel like the Pope visiting the villages around Castel Gandolfo.
We're just grateful, and we're so happy, and on behalf of Leah and myself, thank you. Thank you for being a part of this and for being part of Opera 101 and part of Halo. And we appreciate it.
Thank you, guys. Thank you for spending some of your afternoon with us. Thank you to you three for asking me. Send me the t-shirt. I want a t-shirt. You got it.
It's coming.
You got it. And we're going to, we're going to have you down here in Charleston soon enough.
In September,
maybe even.
Planning an event in September. So stay tuned.
We'll keep everybody on the DL with that. So thank you again. And of course, Ashley, thank you for being so amazing. We appreciate everything. And of course, you people for coming.
You people, all of y'all.
We love that you're here week after week. For those of you visiting for the first time, we're so grateful for you as well. Go check out all of our other classes on our website. And we will see you guys next week for the last Opera 101 for the season. So we're going to have one more conversation. Have a great week. Enjoy it. Will, thank you. Ashley, thank you. All of you guys, enjoy the rest. And we'll see you soon. Bye, everybody.
Bye.